Good morning, good morning, and welcome to everyone. This is our main Sunday morning service at New Testament Baptist Church in Safford, Arizona. Welcome to all of you, everyone that's in the building here with me, everyone that's out there watching on Facebook or wherever. It's great to have you here. God bless each one of you. It's a beautiful day in southeastern Arizona, just gorgeous. So here we are in church. Please take your songbooks. Turn to page 9, if you would, please. Number 9. And if you are able, please stand while we begin our service here. Number 9, Holy, Holy, Holy. Singing. Brother Ron, would you open us in prayer this morning, please?
Our Heavenly Father, Lord God, once again, thank you so much that we can gather before your throne this morning. Our God, we look to you to feed us, to nurture us, God, to strengthen us, and Lord, teach us how to be your kind of people in these last days. Our Lord, we pray that you would be magnified this morning. Be with our pastor as he would bring forth the words of life. Stir us up for your holy name's sake. In Christ's name, amen.
Slide it to its green.
That is green. Just like the Lord has told us. Hopefully, we're getting a little volume here. There we're going. Okay. Did anybody notice what happened this morning? We sang the same song for Sunday. My mistake. It's just I can't read my own notes. I can't keep up with my own stuff. So let's do something else, all right, shall we? Let's do a hymn history. Charles Wesley sent word of his conversion, his salvation, to his mother, Susanna, who didn't know what to make of it. She said, "I heartily rejoice that you have attained to a strong and lively hope in God's mercy through Christ. Not that I can think
that you were totally without saving faith before, but it is one thing to have faith and another thing to be sensible we have it. Well, Charles was now very sensible of having it. His life changed and he gained victory over both his temper and his unfortunate drinking habit. He said, "I was amazed to find my old enemy, intemperance, so suddenly subdued that I almost forgot I was ever in bondage to him." He also began to spread the news of what had happened to him. He wrote, "I preached faith in Christ. New vitality came into Charles's public preaching. He discontinued the practice of reading his sermons and began preaching extemporaneously. He found a faithful arena for ministry in the infamous Newgate prison and allowed himself to be locked up with condemned men on nights before their executions that he might comfort and witness to them during their final hours. As the first anniversary of his conversion approached, Charles wrote an 18 stanza hymn describing his praise to the Lord. It was titled, For the Anniversary Day of One's Conversion. Isn't that neat? The first stanza began, Glory to God and praise and love. Verse 7 began, Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing, inspired by a statement Charles had once heard, quote, Had I a thousand tongues, I would praise him with them all. Beginning with a 1767 hymn book, the seventh stanza was made the first, and when John Wesley compiled his collection of hymns in 1780, he chose this one for the first hymn in the book, which we know today as, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Please turn to page 10 in your hymn books. Page 10, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his great good singing. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of his name. Jesus, a name that charms and fears, that bids our sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for me. Fear him, ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold, your Savior's come, and leap ye lame for joy. Isn't that a beautiful song? Pastor, announcements, please.
All right. If you did not get a bulletin, let me encourage you to get a bulletin, because there's a lot of things happening this week, all right, in particular, and obviously with Thanksgiving going on. Faith Bible Institute tomorrow night will go on. That's not going to change. The midweek service is going to move, however, to Tuesday night. And so at 6:30, the time is also going to change. At 6:30 on Tuesday, we're going to combine the midweek service with Ron's Bible study. And that will be Tuesday evening at 6:30. That will be the midweek service because of Thanksgiving. There will be a Thanksgiving meal at the church at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Thanksgiving Day. So if you do not have any place to go, we would love for you to come and eat with us. We've got plenty of food that's already been signed up for, and folks that are going to be here, we're going to have a good number. We're looking forward to that, and you are all invited to come and to spend that afternoon with us. If you need a ride or something, let me or Sherry know. We'll be glad to pick you up. All right. The ladies' prayer time on Wednesday and the praying Annas on Friday has been canceled because of Thanksgiving week. Saturday morning. Right now, Saturday is sort of up in the air. We're not exactly sure how this is going to fall out with changes coming. We're not sure what the changes are going to consist of. As it stands right now, though, let's announce that we will have the Ladies Cowboy Christmas here at the church at 9 o'clock. The men will prepare breakfast for the ladies at 9 o'clock, and then you're going to go to Cowboy Christmas, and then following that, at about noon is what the plan is. We're going to have a memorial service for Brother Les Hathaway and for their family here at the church at noon. That's the way it stands now. And so if anything does change, you will be notified as best we can. And hopefully by Tuesday night, for sure, we'll be able to announce some specific things going on. Next Sunday was supposed to be a fifth Sunday. We've had a couple of them this month, but so we're considering that. It's also a busy Thanksgiving week. We're considering that. It's we're also trying to we're anticipating that the local government here is going to ask us to be careful about meeting in large groups, and so we're going to try to spool this back a little bit and try to do that. You'll notice we have masks out in the foyer and the table available, and so if you need the mask, if you want the hand lotion, it's there. If you want to use it, we're encouraging you to do whatever is going to make you feel most comfortable. We're all adults, and we understand the concept here. We know that kids are quite easily get over this thing, and many times without any symptoms whatsoever. But if you're older, that's not the case, and so we need to be careful. If we're not older, okay, that's fine, but we need to consider the fact that there are folks that are older, and it's a very dangerous thing. We have several out today because of sickness, so pray for Gail and Mike Daly is there at home. Mike Dykstra's traveling. He's not sick. We're thankful for that. It's good to have John with us and Joanne again. They've been out for a couple of weeks, but they're feeling well enough to be in church, so that's great. We're thrilled that he's able to join us again. All right, so having said all of that, one more real quick thing. Like I said, read through the bulletin, read the missionary of the week, read the church members of the week. So those are good pictures and exciting to try to figure out who everybody is. All right, for the annual Christmas party, okay, we're going to do something a little bit different this year. It is scheduled for December 11th and there's no time here on my announcement because I forgot. I think it's 6 o'clock, but I'm not even sure. Sherry, what do you remember? Anyway, whenever the Christmas party is here at the church, they're asking to bring some finger food and a gift under $10 for each family member. We're going to have a gift exchange, and we're going to do something different this year. We messed with this a little bit last year. And basically, we auctioned some things off, and I can't remember if it was related somehow to the gift exchange, but we're going to try to actually, instead of using fake money or Monopoly money, I think we did last year, we're going to use real money. And we're going to take all of the proceeds that come in for that real money, you know, pennies and nickels and dimes, nickel, dime, quarter stuff, you know, all right. We're not expecting you to bring $1,000, but if you do, we'll take it. No. We're gonna find a missions project and take all of the money that comes in at the missions. Who knows how much it'll be, and we will send it to a missions project. So we're gonna listen carefully as Mike goes through the needs of the missionaries, and perhaps just as we are led as a church here, we'll at the end of the Christmas party, we'll figure out kind of how much has come in and what we can support, and so we'll send it in that direction. So that's what's gonna happen. Please pray for God's guidance on how you can be a blessing for that special offering. So we would encourage you to that end. All right, looking forward to the rest of the service. God bless you. Grab your hymnals once again.
Now, don't forget, our midweek service this coming week is Tuesday, and it's not at our regular time, 6 o'clock. It's at 6:30, Tuesday, 6:30. Now, Pastor, one more time, what time is our Thanksgiving meal on Thursday? It is 1 o'clock. All right. I was under the impression it was not that. Please take your songbooks. Did you folks like what Ryan did while he was here last week? He would maybe sing a stanza, and then he would kind of stop singing, and he would read perhaps the next stanza, and then begin to sing it. Did you guys like that? Did you enjoy that? I see several heads shaking no, and I don't see any shaking doing this. All right. Well, the other thing is the pastor has asked me to make sure I bring a trumpet with me and start playing the trumpet. That's not going to happen. All right. Take your songbooks, please. Turn to page 11. 11. We just did 9. We just did 10, right? See how I take care of you guys. Page 11. This is something that we all need to be doing. Oh, worship the King. Oh, worship the King, all glories above. Oh, gratefully sing His powers and love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girdled with praise. Good singing. Oh, tell of His might, oh, sing of His grace, whose robe is a light, whose canopy space, His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is His path on the wings of the storm. Good singing. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the night. It streams from the hills, it descends to the end, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in Thee do we trust, nor finally to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. Good singing. The next song is not going to be number 12. It's going to be 13 for our last song. 13. Crown Him with many crowns. Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns the music of its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity. Crown Him the Son of God before the worlds began, and ye who tread where He hath trod, crown Him the Son of Man, who every grief hath known, that wings the human breast, and takes and bears them for His own, that all in Him may rest. Crown Him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, who rose victorious to the strife for those He came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death. Let's do the last stanza, number 6. Crown Him the Lord of Heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit through Him dim, from yonder glorious throne. To Thee be endless praise, for Thou for us hast died. Be Thou, O Lord, through endless days, adored and magnified. Good singing. I thank you for that, Pastor.
All right, thank you. Please take your Bibles and turn to 1 Samuel chapter number 7. We have been going through revivals in the Old Testament, and we didn't quite finish them as we went into our revival. We are going to finish them over the next couple of weeks. Today, though, we're going to go back, actually, to read a portion that we've already read, to consider a revival that we've already seen, but I want to look at a specific aspect of that as we go into Thanksgiving week. And so we're going to look at 1 Samuel chapter number 7. Let me give you a little bit of feedback, a little bit rather of review, excuse me, of where we were with this thing. We understand that the state of both religious and national life had really, during the time of the Judges, which is the book that just precedes 1 Samuel, during that time had basically slipped into a new low. There was this cyclic blessing, sin, God's discipline, repentance of the people, restoration to blessing, and then it would just go on and on and on. It would just repeat itself over and over again. But in their repentance, in the people's repentance, there's no indication that actual revival came to the people. It was almost a very pragmatic thing. Well, we need to get some things straight. We need the crops to grow again. We need, you know, this and that. And so it was almost a pragmatic discussion. So prior to Samuel's day, there was never really any evidence of change that had taken place. And so they prayed out of desperation. They wanted relief from their immediate trouble and the issues that their own personal sin had gotten them into. And so there was almost no contrition or any real repentance. Let's say this, they did repent, but it wasn't a lasting repentance. Even as in Samuel's day, even when revival came, we're going to see that they are still going to have some issues. They still are going to, for example, want the king, are they not? Samuel was the high priest, and the high priest was basically the guy what was in charge of the nation. He was supposed to be leading the nation spiritually, and the people wanted a king like everybody else. And so even though for a period of time, God used Samuel to bring revival to the people, it wasn't a permanent thing. And that's a scary thing that ought to bring us to the place that in our hearts, even when we experience revival, even when we experience moments of closeness with God and the awareness of his presence and something that even words cannot describe in our own personal devotions, often that happens. And then we miss that and then we miss it for a little while and then we miss it for a longer while, and pretty soon we've almost forgotten that it ever happened to begin with. And my friends, these things ought not so to be. We ought to be able to go constantly back to the throne of God. Rarely has immorality and corruption achieved anything. You know, rarely has it achieved anything like it did in Israel during this time. I mean, the evil and the wickedness had reached into the high priest's office, not Samuel, but the previous high priest, whose name was, remember, Eli, right? And he was a mess. He was a mess as a father. He was a mess as a high priest and made many mistakes. We saw that. His sons ignored many, many boundaries that they should have been very concerned about. And the Bible says that as wicked as Hophni and Hophni and Phinehas were, Dad was responsible for that. The Bible tells us that God condemned Eli because he let him get away with it. And so it was just wickedness after wickedness. And when wickedness increases, the word of God decreases. When we allow wickedness in our heart and in our lives, the holiness of God and the righteousness of God is forced aside, forced out, and we don't consider it near as we ought to. Well, suddenly there was this break in downward spiral. We talked about that because Samuel shows up and Samuel begins to preach. And we find out, as a matter of fact, if I didn't get you there, turn to 1 Samuel chapter number 7, and we're going to see in verse number 2 that Israel actually lamented over the Lord. Now, we've read these verses prior to this, and we're going to read a couple of verses here in a moment. But I don't want to read this whole passage. Israel is going to lament. They are going to realize, man, we have missed something here. And Samuel is going to tell them in verse number 3, now, if you do return, if you're serious about this, if you're really going to do this, then in verse number 3, he mentions the fact, all right, here's what we need to be careful of here. If you do return, he says, here's what I want you to consider. Get the foreign gods out, he's going to say. He is going to say, fix your heart on God. We looked at this several weeks ago when we looked at this particular revival. Third, Samuel is going to stress, listen, you need to serve him. Serve God only. That's what's important here. Get the foreign gods out. Fix your heart on God. Focus on God. Serve only God. And then the promise of God, which is right at the very end of verse number 3, it's going to tell us there that then God is going to protect them and save them from the Philistines. He's going to drive them out. And I don't know about you, but I want sin driven out of my life. I don't want to have to deal with it all the time. I don't want to have to wake up every day and deal with the same things over and over again. And when it comes to revival, I want this thing once and for all to be done for. And I don't know how long it lasts. I know generationally we see in Scripture that sometimes sin comes back. But we are told in this particular passage, we're going to read that all of the days of Samuel, the Philistines, all of the days of Samuel, they were protected against. The Philistines, rather, did not bother the nation of Israel, all of the days of Israel. And so, as we consider this thing now, I want us to turn to 1 Samuel chapter number 7, where we at. We'll jump up to verse number 10. And it says there, and as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel. Boy, they're offering this burnt offering. They are worshiping God. And you know what? Satan hates it when people worship God, doesn't he? You know, isn't it strange how we can keep commerce rolling strong, man? We can have a plane that seats, you know, 300 people, and it could be filled to capacity. And as long as everybody's wearing a mask, no problem. But you can't meet more than 50 people in a church and spread out. Why would such a goofy rule, why would such a goofy law, why would that even be considered as something that makes sense? Well, if you have no spiritual aptitude, it makes perfect sense because they hate God. They want to stop religious worship. That's what they don't want to stop commerce. It's almost like, listen, all of these people go to Congress, all of these people that send money to what is the word they use in Washington? They have people that will what is that? Lobbying. Yeah, the lobbyists. Okay, all these people are lobbying Congress for these things so that they can have their money and they can get their wealth. You know, the problem in the church is that Christians are not, we have stopped lobbying God. In other words, we're not praying like we ought to be praying. We're not on our knees lobbying God. We have issues. We talk about the swamp in Washington, and there are more people that know about what's happening in Washington and the problems they fear the people that want to pull out the Constitution, and they want to turn away from the Constitution, and they want to do away with the Constitution. And we have all these people that are preaching that know all about the Constitution. And listen, they don't care about the local church. They're not raising a fit that the local church, Christendom, if you will, is such a mess in our society. It's an amazing thing. This is we as a people are absolutely God has answered our prayer. We have been praying for revival, and he has sent us something that would drive us to our knees that we cannot handle ourselves, folks. As miraculous as it was that we look back and think 4 years ago that Trump was elected, we could almost say it was equally unimaginable that he would not be reelected. And we may have all sorts of reasons why we think that happened. But the point is, God is in control. And if nothing else, God has given us an opportunity as a nation. Okay, fine. 4 years. Let's try it and see what happens. And our nation has, one way or another, either you know, regardless of the circumstances, it looks like we're going to have a new president. We are to pray for that president. But God is going to judge America. And now we are dealing with a situation in our country where we are seeing this indictment against the church, where we are more concerned about what happens in Washington. We're more concerned about maintaining the U.S. Constitution than we are maintaining the purity of the Word of God. We want the Constitution to be pure. Well, what about the Word of God? What about standing up and saying, "Thus saith the Lord"? What about making sure that we know what the Bible says and that we actually begin to put it into practice? Because what we say, how we vocalize it, means nothing if we don't live it. And so Samuel, as a priest, as he basically leads the country at this time, he had just called back the people of Israel from their wicked ways. And he had harmonized some very dissenting spirits, and he had recovered the Ark of God. That had recently happened. Revival had come. Let's go back to verse number 10, finish it up here. The Philistines drew near to battle against Israel, but the Lord thundered with a great thunder on that day upon the Philistines and discomfited them, and they were smitten before Israel. And the men of Israel went out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines and smote them until they came under Bethcar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it between Mizpah and Shen and called the name of it Ebenezer, saying, "Hitherto hath the Lord helped us." Ebenezer, that's sort of this stone of remembrance. Ebenezer, thanksgiving, memorials of divine mercy. And how necessary, how important it is that in our lives, there are moments, there are events, there are circumstances when God gets a hold of our heart. And in that moment, we are so convinced that God has done something. Listen, folks, God does not want us to forget that. And we need to, in those moments, nail down some Ebenezers. And so the proper worship of Jehovah here in 1 Samuel was being reestablished. And again, in verse number 7, if you read back there, it so angered the fact that this was happening in Israel, so angered the Philistines that they drew near to battle against Israel, to war against them. And Samuel understood the source of infinite wisdom. In verses 10 and 12, he saw the enemy and he made his appeal to God. And that stone, just like the 12 stones that were brought up from the bed of Jordan, you recall when the Israelites crossed the Jordan River. And they pulled stones from the middle of the river and they brought them to the bank. And they set up some in the river bottom itself, but they brought others to the bank and they set them up. And it was done. This was done in Joshua's day. And it was there to remind them that God had safely brought them into the promised land exactly as he had promised to do. This is an example worthy of imitation by God-fearing men. When God does something in our hearts, does something in our minds, that's why many, many times when we have an evangelist that comes and he preaches and he wants you to respond and he encourages you, listen, he says, come to the altar. Make this event, make what God is doing in your heart right now something that you will not forget. And do that at this place of death, literally, which is what an altar is. And we are to die to self and determine that we are indeed going to move forward for God, having died to self. Because Christ is never going to have control. He will live in our hearts as Christians forever and ever. We're going to go to heaven. But God says, if you want the victory in your personal spiritual lives, we have to die daily. It is my desire here to plead for you to create memorials of divine mercy, to recognize providence, which points to the way and has secured the advantage that God has given you in your life. And I believe that there's no other time of the year that would be more practical than to do this during Thanksgiving time. So first of all, listen very quickly. This is not going to be a long message. Personal experience. When you think about the last 12 months, what do you think, huh? What has the last 12 months brought into your life? Trial, temptation, fear, suffering, victory, steadfastness, right? Maybe some courage. Boy, 2020 is going to be a year that in many cases we remember, but boy, for some crazy reasons. in general, we all remember it for COVID-19 and how it has changed our lives and how it has changed everything in our society, it seems like, so quickly, almost overnight. It's amazing when you stop and think about it. But you know what? There are other people that even through all of this, as difficult as that was, and as difficult as, you know, maybe trips were canceled and other things, you know, that you intended to do, they weren't done with as much freedom. There's a lot of people that wanted to go visit national monuments that were closed down, all kinds of things. But listen, there are some folks that have really, compared to us, their years were even worse. I mean, because in addition to that, maybe a loved one passed away. So they're dealing with that, and they're remembering that, and they're dealing with that. And so through all of this, can we recall God's mercies this year? I mean, the mercies of God are new every day. It would be like trying to count the stars because of what we've been able to get through here. And if we just have a sweet spirit about it, if we would just let God, you know, I mean, so maybe death did sort of shoot at you this year. But hey, if you're here, if you're breathing, you made it through. If you lost a friend or a loved one, you continue to stand unharmed, except for the sorrow. The sorrow is there, but we have all faced far better. We have all fared, rather, far better than Job did. You'll recall what he had to go through. We have nothing to complain about. Indeed, God's been good. So first of all, in our personal experience, we need to stop and thank God for all that he's done. For all that he's done. We need to thank God for our families this year. If anything is more precious to a man than his than just life itself, it would have to be those loved ones that are around him. Family is important. If we don't have biological family, we have friends that we adopt that become our family, and we have folks that maybe are not biologically related at all, but spend time on the phone and look us up, and we create a family. That's important. We see that in our society. That's why you have all the clubs and that's why you have all of the, you know, whatever it is, groups of people that find reasons to have something in common and they hang out together and all wear the same logo or patch, or that's their family of people. All right. Well, listen, have you added to your family in the past year? Maybe you've had a child. Maybe you've had a grandchild. Maybe you've had a great grandchild. Maybe has your family grown? You know, in Israel, in the Old Testament, when a child was born, they would offer that child, not as a sacrifice, obviously, but they would offer a sacrifice to God for that child, a blessing, and asking them for wisdom to raise that child. What a privilege it is. Hannah offered 3 bullocks, an ephah flour, a bottle of wine, as a memorial, as a memorial of Samuel's birth. Remember, his birth in and of itself was a miracle. So families grow. There are few greater days than when a new child is brought into the world. We've got, in our family, I've got 6 brothers and sisters, and they all have kids. And man, there's been some excitement in our family. There's been some good news. We've got folks, I have nieces that are expecting. I have nieces by marriage that are expecting. We see that families are growing and God is blessing, and we're excited about the fact that life is going to go on, and we don't have to worry about tomorrow. We don't need to worry about what's going to happen. And I was telling somebody this week, you know, God has promised that there's going to be seed time and harvest. There's going to be sunshine and rain. There's going to be fall, winter, spring until Jesus comes. We don't have to worry about global warming. All right, so the earth has been warming up, you know, and we might be able to argue that since the flood, when it got pretty cold, and the ice age, as it were. And of course, we don't believe in billions and billions of years, but it's obvious. Hey, all right, so little by little, things are warming up, and people go, oh, the ice melt's gonna. You know, we were supposed to, you'll recall, and Gore said by 2020, New York would be underwater. Well, that didn't happen, did it? And so, hey, hang in there. We're all right. God says everything will be fine. Everything will be just fine. You know what? Yeah, we got to deal with issues, don't we? Cars break down, right? This happens. We got to deal with it. Think about all of your blessings, though. How have your children fared this year? You know, they're fed, they're clothed, they have a home, they have health. Even if a child was lost to death, even if something horribly happened, that individual is in the very presence of God and is in the arms of God if they trusted Christ as Savior. And those are things to be thankful for. All right, maybe this year, how about in the realm of business? I have a son-in-law who basically was out of work. This whole COVID thing, he was self-employed and has a photography business in Tucson, and they were, you know, by threat of, you know, I don't know, thousands of dollars if they even were caught taking one picture. For a while there, it was pretty crazy, and he was without work. It started to spool back up, and we thank the Lord for that. But you know what? Through all of that, God provided. He, the last time I saw him, he was actually kidding around a little bit. He doesn't have the weight problem that I have, but he has a little bit of a tummy. He got a little bit of a pooch, you know. Not very big, just a little bit, but enough for us to kid him a little bit. And apparently my daughter's feeding him well. And so that's all well and good. Even through this whole period, this time, we can trust God. And I'm thankful for that. As hard as it's been on others, we might be able to say, all right, you know what? Wisdom and prudence. Maybe we all had to tighten our belts a little bit. Maybe we all had to have, you know, maybe we ate more of, you know, we had to stay home for 2 weeks if you were quarantined. And maybe you started running out of stuff and you had popcorn every night for 3 or 4 nights. You know, we're alive. We made it, and we can thank God for it. God has met all of our needs this year as a family, Sherry and I. God has met all of our needs this year as a church, giving what it has been great. We were able to spend money on a sound system, upgrades, YouTube stuff that's all live. Now the money that has come in has gone out. We're not hoarding that money. We spent it for the sake of ministry. We started the, I'm not even sure at what point, it was a couple, 3 weeks into this thing, or maybe a month or two into this thing, that all of a sudden we realized, you know what, we're missing a whole necessary, we need to be able to get to Bylas. And so we started the video out in Bylas, that particular ministry. That was something that we're going to have that even when we can go back out there again. We're still going to be able to use that and have that, and that ministry is going to continue to grow. These are, in the midst of all of the difficulty of the hour, God is blessed with many, many things. So now, even though we can't get into the prisons, you can talk to Marty, we're getting into the prisons because now we're taking these videos that we are recording, putting them on a DVD, and even though they're not letting us go in because they're afraid that we might get the guys sick in the prisons, they can watch the services on DVD. And so we're finding ways to get the gospel out. Those of you that are writing to ladies in prison, using Gail as a resource through that, maybe you're writing to the ladies in the nursing home. Those ministries that you're using Gail as that conduit to write letters. Let me encourage you, ladies, to find somebody, at least one person that you write to every week and encourage and share the gospel with. These might be people that will admit that they are saved, and or at least they will declare to be saved, and maybe they are. I trust they are. But they might also be people that are not saved. They just want somebody to talk to. And you know what? Perhaps over a period of time, you can establish a relationship. And actually, through letters written in the mail, you can lead somebody to Christ. What a privilege that would be. And what a direct, I mean, you would be fulfilling the very responsibility that you and I have as Christians to live in this world. We would be obeying Christ in it. And so, I know that business-wise, we look around and there are some people that are you know, their businesses have perhaps even failed in some respects, but I know others in the church that are very, very busy in our own church. I know Christy Tinkle says she's busier than one-armed paper hanger right now, trying to sell all of her Tingle treasures. God has blessed in some of these ways, and so we need to be grateful to God. How many of us would be thankful for God if we were guaranteed that just in 1 year from today, we would have exactly what we have today? Well, God promises that he is going to give us more. President James Madison, he was the fourth president of the United States. He was a very sick man in his waning years. He is hailed, Madison was hailed as the father of the Constitution. And that was because of his pivotal role in writing the Constitution and in writing the Bill of Rights. He, like the woman with the issue of blood in the New Testament, had suffered many things from many physicians and was none the better for it. An old friend wrote the president and sent him some vegetable pills and begged that he try them and let him know the result. And so the president took the pills and he tried the pills. And this was his reply. He said, "My dear friend, I thank you very much for that box of pills. I have taken them, every one. And while I cannot say that I am any better since taking them, it is quite possible I might have been worse if I had not. So I beg you to accept my gratitude." It's how you look at it. It's how you look at it, right? We can be thankful. Look back over the year. Has the Lord not helped you? And does the Bible have anything to say to man who is perhaps we've gone through a very difficult time financially, maybe even perhaps bordering on bankruptcy? The Bible says, "Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of things which he possesseth." Hey, maybe if nothing else, we're learning that this is not our home. If nothing else, we're learning to take our eyes off of this short-sighted. Listen, when the rapture comes, you know what's going to happen? I guarantee you, it will not take long at all for people to realize, hey, the churches are empty. And they're gonna bust into here. They're gonna rip out the sound system. They're gonna take anything of any value in the building. It's gonna be gone. It's gonna be toast. Whatever we have in your home, they're gonna go through your home. They're gonna rifle through your home. They're gonna take whatever they can. They're gonna take your food. They're gonna try to find your weapons. We got all this stuff, and And God is saying, it doesn't matter. Don't worry about it, because it's not going to last. What lasts is what you send on ahead. Tithes and offerings and gifts and love offerings and what you send forward in missions and faith, promise, all of those things, that's what's going to last. That's what we're going to have forever and ever and ever. All of this stuff in the world is just going to be, it's going to be done away with. And God is saying, put your eyes on the future. Move your eyes on what God has promised us tomorrow, because it's going to be far better than anything that we have today. And finally, spiritual progress. We're going to be done a little bit early, and I'm almost sure of that. And what about the spiritual progress? What spiritual progress have you made this year? I wonder. For one, I felt somebody gave testimony yesterday at men's prayer, and I was feeling the exact same thing. I wish I had given the testimony. I could have. I kind of, almost as soon as he started, I knew where he was going. But they said, you know what? After the revival was over, Monday was like, okay, nice deep breath. You know, okay, Monday, we're there. But then Tuesday night was like, man, I want to go back to church. I miss that. I miss being in church every night. That was really good. And that's exactly the way I felt. It was like, man, that was really cool. That was really great. We were in church and hearing the preaching of the Word of God, and we were learning, and it was fresh, wasn't it? It's always good to have somebody else. They have a different vocabulary, right? They have a different way to present it. They love the Lord, and they have information that helps us, and that's what an evangelist does. And when he brings a team like our, like Brother Van Gelderen did, when he brings a group of people to our church, and we're encouraged with different instruments. The trumpet was great, and gives me something to mess with Marty about, it's a lot of fun. And you know what? We're going to have all eternity to talk about what that revival meant. And one of the questions that Brother Van Gelderen may ask in eternity is, did it stick? We were praying for our revival during the week, and more times than once, Brother Van Gelderen would pray for the churches that he had been in the past, that the revival that started, or that the decisions that were made back then were decisions that would continue to be made. And are those people still living for God? Are they still doing right? Are they still making choices that please God? And so spiritually, how has our progress been this year? Are the fruits of the Spirit more apparent? Are they more abundant? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness. Against such things there is no law. Boy, there's no law against them, but man, oh man, is that hard. That is hard. That is hard to love somebody that hates you. That is hard to be kind to somebody who despitefully uses you. That is hard. That's why you need the Holy Spirit of God, isn't it? That's why I need the Holy Spirit of God. If living the Christian life was easy to do, we wouldn't need the Holy Spirit, but we need the Holy Spirit. And so are they more abundant than ever before? And if they're not, are we weeping? We've got sin in our nation, and there are some things. You know what? We cannot necessarily, I don't know what in the world I could possibly do to stop abortion. Okay? I mean, yes, we can give to lobbyists that are trying to stop abortion. But God doesn't say, do that and I'll send revival. Does it break our hearts enough to bring tears to our eyes? We can pray that much. Can we pray to God? Does it really burden our hearts that the slaughter of unborn children, innocents, where they are the most safe in the entire world? If a baby is safe anywhere, it ought to be in their mommy's belly. That ought to be the safest place. And the sin in our society and in our world, it ought to break our hearts. And even though we may not be able to stop it, it ought to break our hearts. It ought to bring us to the point of repentance. And that's what, to the place where we pray and we literally weep, like Jeremiah the prophet when he saw the sins of the nation of Israel. The church of God. You know what? I'm so excited. We have had folks saved in our church this year. We have had folks saved in our ministries this year. I enjoy reading some of our prayer letters because almost and very consistently, the missionaries that we have sent around the world are seeing souls saved and baptized and added to the church. That should be something that encourages us. We're involved in this thing. We need to continue to pray for God to bless. Just think about it for a second. If you were in a third world country and you visited their temples and their places of worship, if you have never been in a third world country, if you've never been in India, if you have never been in some of these places where they don't have enough to eat, hardly themselves, and yet you find that they bring to the temple entire meals and they leave them sit there until they rot for their gods when their families are starving. Does that bother you? Bonahas in Cambodia. Boy, those are precious people. He's on Facebook quite a bit, and I so appreciate that. I love seeing what he posts and how he interacts with the people. I don't understand a single word that he says. The language, I don't even understand the alphabet of the language is crazy, if you ask me. But Brother Haas loves the Lord and he loves those people and God is blessing his ministry there. And let me encourage you to know, listen, we're gonna get to heaven and we're gonna thank God that we supported Brother Haas and we're gonna thank God that we were a part of that ministry and he's gonna be able to introduce us to all the people that he led to the Lord because of the faith that he demonstrated in taking him and his wife Ty over there. What a blessing. Now listen, we should be excited about the fact that we're going to introduce to him people that while he was working there leading people to Christ, we were working here leading people to Christ. What an exciting time that is. We see, and it's amazing how superstition in other countries and pictures and candles and everything that's set up and if we're going to raise up an altar, which is what this is all about, a memorial. If we're going to raise something up to God, if we're going to raise a memorial up to God, we're not going to have a church full of candles down here. You light a candle and supposedly that's the prayer going up. Now that's religious nonsense. It's a way to make money for the church. That's all that is. It's a way to listen. So give God something. Give him a memorial. Thank him for what he's done in your life. And you can do that by offering yourself a sacrifice. As a matter of fact, let's turn to one verse. We're going to be done. Go to Romans chapter number 12. Let's just go there quickly. And I'm going to read one verse. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, Romans 12, 1, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. God is not asking for you or I to do anything that is unreasonable. He saved us. He died for us. He is God of in heaven. He created the world. He created the universe. When you stop and think about, listen, when we step into eternity, have you ever stopped to wonder what that would be like? Okay, and then like multiply that like 1,000 times, and we're still probably not even going to be close. We are going to be flat on our faces before a holy God in a very holy place. And at that point, we're going to have tears. What brings you to tears? Does anything? My dad, the older he got, he seemed to be very emotional. And I don't know if that was related to age, but I do find myself from time to time becoming like emotional over silly things. Somebody that does something for the very first time that maybe never thought that they could do it. Maybe a child. You ever watch a YouTube video where a child who gets, hearing aids, I can't remember what they call them, but there we go, the implants. And all of a sudden they hear their mom's or dad's voice for the very first time. And their eyes get big, and it's just sometimes I watch those, and I tell you what, they bring tears to my eyes sometimes. That's an exciting moment. That's an event that is, that is something. And all kinds of things. Now, that's something that even when I was young, I think would have affected me. Sometimes now there are things that affect me. I go, okay, that's kind of stupid, Randy, grow up. But maybe I'm just getting old. I don't know. But my point is this. What brings you to tears? Does heaven bring you to tears? Does God bring you? Do you think about what God means to you, what he ought to mean to you? Does that bring us to amazing, thankful tears, which is what Thanksgiving is all about? One of the newspapers called this week and interviewed me for about 20 minutes, I guess. And wanted to know what we were preaching and how we were preparing for Thanksgiving and what we could be thankful for. I tried to talk about some of these things and share the fact that, listen, we are to be thankful every single day of the year, not just one day out of the year, but every day for all that God has done for us. And so every head bowed and every eye closed. I think we're going to sing hymn number 26. I want to throw Rachel a loop there. We're going to sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, hymn 26. And we're going to allow God to speak to our hearts. And I just want you to stop. I want this to be a very solemn, a very, very worshipful time as we sing quietly, very carefully, very, very, very slowly through this song, all three verses, and then we're going to be dismissed this morning. Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I remain, Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I know thy by good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it, why? Seal it for thy courts above. If you don't know for sure that you're saved and on your way to heaven, don't leave here without knowing that for sure. Talk to me, talk to my wife, pull us aside. What a privilege it would be for us to take the word of God and show you. You can know for sure that you're on your way to heaven. Christian, let's be thankful. Let's be thankful for all that God has done. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, this hour, Lord, this week. Go before us. We ask and pray, Lord, that your will would be done in our hearts and lives. We pray, Lord, that every opportunity we have this week, to talk to someone about you would not be lost. We ask and pray, Lord, that you would use us to bring honor and glory to your Son, Lord, our Savior. Heavenly Father, we are thankful. We don't even understand, Lord, how thankful that we ought to be. Lord, I pray that you would, Lord, teach us, break our hearts, help us to see, to consider, Lord, you this week. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you tonight, 6 o'clock.